Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Protests in Kashmir leave 11 dead. Second round of Israeli-Palestinian talks begins in Egypt. And Iraqi refugees in Jordan are still waiting for improved security in Iraq before returning home. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
Clashes broke out between hundreds of protesters and Indian security forces in Kashmir. This comes one day after the region witnessed its most violent clashes of the past two decades, with incessant protests for independence.
Clashes broke out in the two towns of Baramulla and Zinakot, near Kashmir's summer capital, Srinagar, wounding five protesters and one policeman. Thousands of policemen and semi-military forces are deployed on the streets of the city to enforce the curfews that have been imposed on Kashmir.
The Eid al-Fitr holiday in Indian-ruled Kashmir was different than that of other places around the world. Its summer capital, Srinagar, seemed like a quarantine city after its residents were confined to their homes and forbidden to go outside because of the curfew that was imposed in the city. The bustling life in the streets stopped, shops and libraries were closed, and the streets are now deserted, except for a large number of military troops and policemen. The city is now mourning the 18 people who were killed in the protests of the last 2 days, when bloody confrontations broke out between the protesters and security forces. It was the bloodiest clashes since the wide-scale protests began in June.
The
deterioration of the security situation prompted the Indian authorities to suspend air flights into Srinagar. At least 88 people have been killed in the protests throughout this summer.
An estimated
68,000 people in Kashmir have been killed by Indian security forces since the beginning of the independence movement 21 years ago. The trigger of these current confrontations was pulled in June when police killed a young Kashmiri man. Since then, Kashmiri residents have been throwing stones at military and security forces and setting vehicles on fire. The police have absolutely never hesitated in responding, randomly opening fire at the crowds of protesters, leading to more deaths and further fueling the violence. The confrontations of the last 2 days coincided with a goodwill meeting of Indian officials seeking to ease tension in the region that is divided between India and Pakistan. Yesterday, Indian Prime Minister Manmohan Singh expressed his readiness to talk with the Kashmiri people and respond to their demands. New Delhi will absolutely not be at ease with those demands, especially if they pertain to its sovereignty over a region that is rich in natural sources, such as Kashmir.
The
majority of Kashmir's residents demand independence from India and complete integration into Pakistan.
جولة ثانية من المفاوضات المباشرة الفلسطينية الإسرائيلية بدأت في مدينة شرم الشيخ.
A second round of direct Palestinian-Israeli negotiations started in the Egyptian city of Sharm el-Sheikh with a tripartite meeting between Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, and Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas. Preliminary indicators seem positive, even though the atmosphere is tense due to the settlement issue. Israel has refused to extend the settlement freeze, while the Palestinians are threatening to halt the negotiations if settlement construction resumes, a dispute that Cairo tried to resolve before the start of this round of talks, as Egyptian President Hosni Mubarak held separate meetings with the Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas and Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu.
والعقبة الرئيسية في طريق المفاوضات المباشرة بين الفلسطينيين.
The main obstacle facing the direct negotiations between the Palestinians and the Israelis is the Israeli settlements that occupy Palestinian land and hold a large number of settlers. Perhaps the motive behind Israel's insistence on building settlements is the fact that their number in the West Bank has exceeded 480.
480 موقعا تشتمل على مستوى.
These include settlements, wells, and military sites currently inhabited by over 500,000 settlers. Their yearly growth rate stands at 4%, and they currently occupy 40% of the West Bank's territory. The majority of settlers are concentrated in Jerusalem, where they form 55% of the population. With 28 settlement sites, the largest number of settlements is in the city of Jerusalem.
Iran has released one of the three American citizens who were detained in July 2009 for illegal entry.
I want to really offer my thanks to everyone in the world, all of the governments, all of the people that have been involved, and I especially and particularly want to address President Ahmadinejad and all of the Iranian officials and the religious leaders and thank them for this humanitarian gesture. I'm grateful. And I'm very humbled by this moment.
Sarah Shorard has left Tehran for Oman after her release. Shorard, along with her two fellow Americans, were arrested while entering from Iraqi border. Tehran charged the three with espionage. Last week, Iran's judiciary said Shorard, the only female detainee, could be released on a bail of $500,000 on health grounds. Or before leaving Tehran, Sarah Shorard had a brief meeting with Maryam Mojtahedzadeh, advisor to the Iranian president.
We allowed you to have a meeting with your mother when she was on a visit to Tehran. While we have no relationship with your country, it's a good example of compassion we have learned from the Holy Quran.
Shorard said in response that she knows about Islamic teachings. She said she will remain committed to the truth in her future interviews with media.
Before I was in prison, when I lived in Damascus, I studied Islam, and I've read books about specifically women's treatment, in the Holy Quran and the way that women are addressed, and it's something that I've learned a lot from women in the Middle East, in this part of the world, and I have a lot of respect for women and the tradition that surrounds them. I just want to assure you that my commitment to truth will not change even when I go back to my country, and I will never say anything but the truth to the media, and I will not succumb to any pressure.
Earlier, Tehran chief prosecutor told us more about the condition of Shorard and the two other American detainees.
After completion of legal proceedings of the American detainees, we decided to give some assistance to Ms. Shorard because of her health condition. So the judge issued her release order immediately after her representatives accepted to bail her out through Bank Milli of Iran in Muscat. Now Ms. Shorard is free to leave Iran if she wants to. However, the detention period of the other two is extended. Their dossiers have been sent to the Revolution Court, which is in charge of espionage charges. We should now wait for the trial session.
The United Nations announced that the Somali Shabab al-Mujahideen group has become a dangerous threat to the international community and has called on the transitional Somali government to put an end to the conflict.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
بعد تقرير جديد للأمم المتحدة أشار في
In a new UN report, the UN Secretary General warned of the serious threat posed by the Somali Al-Shabaab group. The Somali issue will be put on the agenda of the UN Security Council's meeting this coming Thursday and on the UN General Assembly meeting next week.
The July attack in Kampala, which was carried out by the Somali Shabab and killed scores of civilians, made the international community aware of the group's capability to plan and execute attacks outside Somalia. The latest UN report considered the group to be a dangerous threat to Somalia and the international community at large. The UN report also pointed to the importance of the transitional federal government in Somalia and called on it to quickly act to solve its internal conflicts and meet the imminent financial needs of the African Union forces. The report also mentioned the pirates by the Somali coast and their negative effects on the security of the sea and the ships in the region. جير أبو داكا
تنطلق خلال أيام اجتماعات دول منطقة الساحل.
In the next few days, the community of Sahel-Saharan states will hold conferences to initiate a joint intelligence program to fight terrorism. Security officials from Algeria, Mauritania, Mali, and Niger will attend the meeting.
The decision to build a new intelligence force to support the Joint Military Command based in southern Algeria's city of Tamanrasset is the most important announcement that the Algeria conference will make in the coming days. This is an overdue meeting, and it comes after the phenomenon of kidnapping Western tourists became rampant and turned into an indirect sponsorship of Salafi groups in the region. The new intelligence force aims to gather relevant information for the joint military forces of the Sahel-Saharan countries. This information mainly relates to the activities of terrorist groups within the tribes that are spreading in southern Algeria, Mauritania, northern Mali, Niger, and Burkina Faso, in addition to their connection to the trafficking networks that smuggle and sell drugs and trade weapons. The information that the intelligence force will gather is meant to enable the joint military forces to intervene in these activities at the right time. These proposed plans block the plans of the U.S. and France, which are trying to create a base for themselves in the Sahel region. Despite that fact, they welcomed Algeria's alliance with the countries of the Sahel region. Political analysts believe that this is the beginning of Algeria's solid and successful fight against the phenomenon of terrorism and terrorist groups. Faiza Harzala, Al Arabiya.
Hi, I'm John Hamilton, a journalist and a supporter of Link TV. As someone who cares very deeply about getting to the truth of what goes on in this world of ours, I appreciate the range of opinions and voices I see every day on Mosaic, world news from the Middle East. And right now, Mosaic is on a mission to bring this unique program to homes across America. But we need your help. We want to raise $100,000 during this month-long pledge drive. One of the best ways to show your support is to donate $100 or more to Link TV. When you do, we'll send you our new Mosaic Intelligence Report t-shirt. Do you have intelligence? We know that you do, and we also know you'll love showing your friends and family how much Mosaic means to you. Or if you want to be a real hero to independent media, you can give a gift of $1,000 or more. And when you do, you'll get to have lunch with producer Jamal Dejani the next time you come to San Francisco. You'll also get a behind-the-scenes look at the Mosaic Studios to see for yourself how an episode of Mosaic is put on the screen. Mosaic wants to bring their unique brand of independent journalism into new homes across the country. Currently, Mosaic is seen via satellite here on Link TV and on some cable networks. Well, we want to reach new audiences in news stations across the country. So please, make a real difference for balanced reporting and call 866-485-8848 or open up your web browser to linktv.org and click that Give Now button. And from all of us here at Link TV, thanks for your support.
إندونيسيا أكبر دولة إسلامية في العالم، ولطالما كان للتسامح الديني.
Indonesia is the world's largest Islamic state. For long, religious tolerance was a non-issue. However, religious tension has recently started to become a characteristic of Indonesian society, as the country has been witnessing attacks on churches and religious minorities. Today, all eyes turn to Bekasi, one of Jakarta's suburbs, where a dispute over land on which Christians want to build a place of worship is threatening to turn into a large-scale religious conflict.
بالتحول إلى نزاع ديني أوسع.
هذه الاستعدادات تتكرر كل يوم أحد لحماية القداس في بيكاسي.
These preparations take place every Sunday. They are meant to protect the mass in Bekasi. In the past few weeks, Christians here have been holding their weekly service under tight police protection. Police are trying to prevent a repeat of the clashes that took place between Christians and Muslims who are fighting over the fate of a piece of land. This is the piece of land. The situation in Bekasi wasn't always this way. This Christian woman has peacefully lived with her Muslim neighbors for decades. However, such disturbances are threatening their coexistence.
لكن مثل هذه المشاحنات تهدد التعايش.
They are closed-minded. I don't know how they view their God. I feel that my God protects me, but it seems like they are constantly in need of defending their God.
Murhali Barda, who can be seen arguing with a policeman, is the leader of the Islamic Defender Front in Bekasi. Christians believe that the group is behind the violence. Murhali warns that the matter will further escalate if the Christians continue to hold mass on this piece of land.
سيؤدي إلى تصعيد.
If we are invited for jihad, then we won't care if we live or die. Christians only have themselves to blame.
The problems in Bekasi have captured everyone's attention in Indonesia. Many voices are calling on the government to interfere in order to put an end to religious intolerance.
We are doing what we can. But we must do these things.
We are doing what we can, but we must do these things within the democratic process. When you want to ensure civil liberties, it is civil liberties to all.
When you want to ensure civil liberties, it's civil liberties to all.
In Bekasi, another Sunday Mass takes place under police protection. Meanwhile, Indonesia is trying to find a solution to guarantee that religious tension does not turn into a nightmare.
إلى الأوضاع الأمنية المتردية في البلاد إذ قتل جنديان حكوميان وأصيب ثلاثة آخرون.
At the deteriorating security level, two Iraqi government soldiers were killed and three others were wounded in a bomb attack that targeted their patrol vehicle south of Kirkuk in the capital of Tamim province. Meanwhile, an Iraqi was killed and two others were wounded in a sticky bomb blast that targeted their car in the county of Khalis, north of Bakuba, the capital of Diyala province. In addition, seven people, including women and children, were wounded in a bomb attack on a communications transmission tower north of Tikrit in the capital of Salah al-Din province. Moreover, the director general of the Iraqi Ministry of Agriculture was wounded when unknown gunmen opened fire on him west of Baghdad.
شيع قارب قتل الهجوم على أحد مقر الجيش الحكومي ذويهم من الضحايا اليوم.
In another development, the relatives of victims who were killed in the attack on the Iraqi military post held a funeral procession that started at the Baghdad morgue. More than 12 people were killed and 36 others were wounded in the attack that was launched on an Iraqi army post. The attack was part of a string of bombings that have raised concern over the ability of the Iraqi security agencies to maintain stability in the country.
يأمل اللاجئون العراقيون في الأردن بتحسن الأوضاع في بلادهم.
Iraqi refugees in Jordan have expressed hope that the security situation in the country will improve so they can return. The refugees are facing many hardships and obstacles, especially in accessing the necessary services available to them.
The grants pledged to aid Iraqi refugees and the displaced have turned into a major crisis due to mismanagement and the high number of applicants.
Generally, the Iraqi Ministry of Displacement and Migration is responsible for allocating aid to the refugees. This program was not random, and it was based on studies.
Meanwhile, Iraqi refugees are complaining about the lack of services amidst their dire living conditions.
They have been holding our passports for 6 days at the Rafidayin Bank. We don't know what happened to our passports. It has been 6 days. We come here every day from the morning until the late afternoon, leaving our children alone at home. God doesn't accept this. This is humiliation for the Iraqi nation. They don't hand the papers to you. Instead, they throw it at you while you're standing at the window. Isn't this humiliation for Iraqi women? Isn't it shameful to see Iraqi women crowded with men in queues? Shame on them. The Iraqi government should resign. This is not a government. It's a government of thieves. Don't they see the humiliation? We are a nation of civilization and goodwill. Look at what happened to us. May God punish those responsible.
The Rafidayin Bank, which is responsible for allocating grants to the Iraqi refugees, in cooperation with the UN Refugee Agency in Amman, has designated only one center for the disbursement of funds, making it extremely difficult for the refugees.
The bank doesn't have a good system. They hired illiterate employees who don't know how to work the system. Shame on them. They are hired because of who they know, not what they know. Thousands of Iraqi refugees continue to be humiliated. Jordanian security officers can't contain this chaos, even if they wanted to. I'm not saying that to patronize the Jordanian security institution or its Iraqi counterpart. Just come and see for yourself.
Many of the displaced Iraqis come from faraway areas, incurring unnecessary expenses just to arrive here at this distribution center to ask for help. Once here, they are shocked to find how difficult and lengthy the process is, adding more hardships to their lives. This case of suffering is not among one of the hundreds of cases facing Iraqi refugees, but one of the thousands. No matter where the refugees go, their situation remains unchanged, especially after their country was stolen and turned into a testing ground, their resources stripped away, their intellectuals displaced, and after all this, peace and security eliminated. Throughout his life, composed of imprisonment, writing, and solitude, this Syrian writer and poet drank from the cup of bitterness. Muhammad al-Magut is our today's figure. My colleague Ogari Tandash brings you the following report.
I am a Bedouin singing in the orchestra of deserts. I am a man of darkness and shadow. In my life, I never sit still in the middle of the road. I often stay in a lonely corner, hoping for the barefooted and the ghost cars to come in the same street. It was from this lonely corner that Muhammad al-Magut began his file on human suffering, to be submitted to God and characterized by the hungry and the despaired. But al-Magut, frankly, announced to these hungry people, after long years of struggling by their side, "Oh, all the miserable people in the world, the only thing I fear is that God is blind." In the village of Salamiya, Muhammad al-Magut was born to witness the hardships of the poor. For him, Salamiya was surrounded by horror in the north, havoc in the south, dust in the east, and ruins and crows in the west. He later went to Damascus for his high school education. But after the school hung him on a school wall as punishment for mischief, making him the laughingstock of his classmates, his father sent the school a letter asking them to have mercy on him. This is what made him run away from school and return to Salamiya. In Salamiya, he joined the Syrian Social Nationalist Party. Once, he was asked why he joined the party, and he answered sarcastically, "Because the party's headquarters was close to my home, and they had artillery in it." But al-Magut, who at this point had begun to write and publish his work, paid a price for his affiliation with the party after Adnan al-Maliki's assassination in 1955 and the whole nation's condemnation of it. Magut was detained in Mazdi prison. Behind bars, he truly began his literary career and got to know the poetry of Adonis. He said at the time that prison forces a poet to introspect and observe and makes him more coherent to the outside world. During Syria and Egypt's period of unity, Magut was wanted in Damascus. So in the late 1950s, he decided to escape and illegally enter Lebanon on foot. There, Magut joined the Poetry Magazines Association. On the sidewalks of Beirut, he wandered with poet Badr Shakir Sayab. The latter said that Magut spoke the truth, yet gained lies in return. He married poet Sonia Saleh, with whom he stayed until her last breath in 1985. He said about her, "She guided me like a compass, accompanied me like a mythical story in my life." Magut returned to Damascus in the late 1950s and began his poetic and theatrical productions until he was imprisoned again for 3 months. In the 1970s, Magut worked in Damascus as the editor-in-chief of Sirta magazine and finished his plays Tishrin's Village and Exile. At the same time, he contributed with others in defining the character and nature of the Syrian newspaper Tishrin and its distribution. Magut was bold in his book, I Will Betray My Homeland. But he was the poet and writer who once announced that he loved his country as a prisoner who refuses to leave jail and dies inside its walls. When some people said that Magut was a series of lost bets, he answered, no, Magut was with the lost causes until his death. The Master of Words passed away while speaking on the phone on April 3, 2006. He had said that real poetry would never die. Indeed, he still lives in between the lines of his poems, and his name will be remembered in the history of great poets.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible from support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online, stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.